Okay, I hope you can see it now. So, Daniel, thanks so much for giving us the opportunity to discuss these issues here. I think at the end of the session, you asked a very important question, which is, just a second, I'm in the wrong slide here. Hold on a moment, just bear with me for a second. There we go. Okay, because I mean, we've seen some fantastic work done with environmental DNA. Now the question is, can we use it in real life? And I think you gave some very nice examples on possibilities. And for my take, I think we are pretty much at the point where it's already useful. So what we're going to discuss are some opportunities and challenges for real life applications of eDNA technology. And in this session, we have three very complementary talks on making eDNA mainstream. So we all know that this is a robust approach. And I think one of the main advantages of doing eDNA is by moving the entire field from analog to digital. Because once you sequence the DNA, we are working in the digital world. It's easy to redo analysis with new information that becomes available and refine analysis as methods improve. So, sharing the data has been much easier because in the DNA sequencing genomics world, this is something that we already do from the beginning. And unfortunately, environmental assessment work hasn't always been very forward about sharing data, sometimes because people are not willing to, and sometimes because it's not in the mindset. So I think the possibility of data sharing, reanalysis, it's objective. I mean, sometimes if you're looking at a species, there's a degree of subjectivity in identifying that species, but that's not visible because you either have a name or you don't have a name, but you don't know how sure you are of that name. And as you see, and you have seen in other talks, it's quite comprehensive. So to do this, we prepared for you three talks. The first one is by myself, and I'll give you one example on how the technologies have been used in the Amazon, in the Brazilian Amazon. The second talk by Dirk Steink, who's from the Center for Biodiversity Genomes. At the center, they have done an enormous amount of work on generating reference libraries and on environmental DNA. So their expertise on the approaches that are available are just fantastic. And although Dirk could spend the entire day telling us about work that he's done on that, I asked him to focus on technical challenges. I mean, the technology is there, but we still have work to do to make it fully useful. And finally, I've asked Diego Bento, who is a friend and colleague from ICM Bio, the environmental agency in Brazil. He's an analyst there. And all this is nice and good, and we can do fantastic work, but how real life it will be if the agencies that regulate environmental licensing and monitoring in Brazil do not put this into the legislation to how they operate. So Diego is going to tell us some ideas he has around this, especially from the perspective of SECAV, which is the agency within ICMB that looks at cave, not only biodiversity, but cave protection. So I'll get started immediately. So the perspective I'll bring to you is on the use of DNA and metabarcoding for environmental studies in the Amazon. And when I'm talking about the Amazon, I actually am talking about a very specific place that we do quite a bit of work in the Amazon. So for the Brazilians here, you're familiar with the map. This is the eastern region of the Amazon in the state of Pará. And the work we conduct mostly is in this area here, which is the Carajás Mosaic. So you see that this is a well-protected area. Unfortunately, it's already an island. Pretty much disconnected for other protected areas. We are trying to fix that. And this is how it was in 1973. So you move along to today, and this is what you see. you see that the eastern side of the region has been completely devastated. And all you see are small patches of forest that if you add up everything is about 30% of forest coverage, but it's very, very fragmented, quite useless as habitats for many species. On the contrary, the mosaic of Carajás, which is made of different types of protected areas from areas of native people to new national park that's of ferruginous fields over in this region. And in this area here, we have the National Forest of Carajás that was designed to host mining activities. So when it was set up, it was set up so that mining could occur in the area while the environmental agency would have a better control on how things would develop in the region. So this here is a picture of the National Forest. This picture was taken from the edge of the South Range here. And you see that's a quite interesting environment. Contrary to what most people think about the Amazon, it's not flat, it's quite hilly. This is over 800 meters above sea level. We have lakes and we have this area here that some people think it's been cut, but this is actually native. This is what we call the Kanga fields or the ferruginous fields, which create a very unique environment for plants. And you see that the forest goes up to the edge here. And on this edge, we can find hundreds and thousands of caves in the entire region. So this is the environment we're working on. It's highly biodiverse. And we have used some of these eDNA approaches. And I will show you very briefly some of the results. This is a picture of the S11D mining operation, which happens at the edge of the Southern Range. And so what we're trying to do here is to enable mining in the industrial mining operations to happen within this area, taking care of the forest and make sure that we have no loss of biodiversity. So this work will be mostly discussing the flora of the region. So this is a picture of the Kanga, and the previous work that enabled all of this was the description of the flora of the Kanga of the Amazon. This is unfortunately the only flora that has been fully described for the Amazon. So when we started, there were about 200 species that were known, and most of the licensing work was done considering these 200 species. But once we described the entire flora, we have something like 1,066 species, 38 of which are endemic to the area. And fortunately, we were able to collect material to obtain DNA and construct the reference libraries for the region. So this is quite unique as well for the country in which you have a flora and the reference DNA library for this. And it already helped us to identify new species, sort species complex and many other things. And it has become a working tool for the studies in the region. This is a paper that was published recently with the first view of the reference library for the plants of the Kanga. So in this paper, we provide sequences from 1,100 specimens, which represent over 500 species and over 320 genera. So it's not complete yet, but it's a very nice first step that then, with this in mind, at hand, we are able to use eDNA technologies. And the one example I'll show you is on this work we did at these three sites. So this is also in the Southern Range, eastern to the picture I showed earlier. You can see that the Kanga have at least four quite distinct phytophysiognomies. And this one I'll describe today is exclusively looking at the brushland as an example. So, and the reason we chose some of these areas is because they were previously studied by consultants, and then we can make direct comparisons of the work. And for these three areas, we have collected 60 samples between them. So I won't go into the nitty-gritty detail, I just get the main messages here. So the first message is that we identified 565 OTUs. So that means that, as I mentioned earlier, our reference library it was a very nice tool, but it's still not complete, as we know. And plus, we obviously have interference from the forest. There's material that's carried over to this region, and we do detect it, but we don't have the reference library for the forest. This is something that we are working on right now. So I only will describe the ones for which we have hits with the local database so that we could give things names. And even with just that, we see more species than what the consultant work saw. Okay, so number of species they observed were 37, and we observed 30, and we observed 37. So I won't get into, I don't have time to get into more details, but with the eDNA work, we can see much broader, have a much wider vision than the consultants can. And also, we see it much more consistently. If we look at sample by sample, we see things repeatedly, while if you look at sample by samples to the what consultants do, it varies quite a bit. So this is another way of comparing the plots. So you see that these two plots are close together, this green and red plots, and we do see that they are much more similar to each other than this blue plot over here, which is close to a forest patch over here. So we have a mixing of the two phytophysiognomies. And so it has a distinct plant coverage than these two. So this is just another way of showing that we can consistently describe these areas using eDNA. We can describe them with a broader, we see more things than usually consultants can see, and we see things more consistently. This is not the only application that we are using in the area. So I'll give you a few more examples that this is not does not cover all the work that we are doing, but we are using eDNA to look at rivers and lakes. So I showed you some pictures of lakes in the region. So you can see here that we can easily distinguish the rivers and the lakes by the content of the eDNA that's in these libraries. And we even were able to capture some invasive species that are now the company is trying to remove from one of these lakes. We also are studying ferruginous caves. And this is really important because collecting specimens from the caves is quite time consuming. Working in the cave environment is something that has danger attached to it. And so if we can identify the species by using eDNA, that would be extremely helpful. And so we are at the moment constructing reference libraries for special invertebrate species, but also bats. And we have sampled extensively caves, and that work, some of it has been concluded already, but I don't have time to go into it. And something that we have started more recently, we have collected hundreds of samples around the Ponta de Madeira port, which is one of the largest ports for shipment of grains in Brazil, grains and iron ore. And this work aims at identifying invasive species and also comparing the status of the port versus native areas in the region. So to conclude this, I firmly believe that DNA is a robust application, and we have evidence that it can deliver results more consistently than what typical work does. But I, at this moment, I'm not ready to stop everything and let's do it all by eDNA. We clearly understand that there is more work to make sure that the technology is there for us to use it. And in addition, as Diogo will say, we have issues with, we still need to work with the environmental agencies to make this mainstream. There is obviously a lack of reference libraries, even when some work has been done. And I won't get into this because probably Turk will get more into the details on what needs to be improved. So we know that there are some DNA extraction issues. We tested a lot of kits and we see variations in that. Primers and sequencing methods are also need to be further developed. In data analysis tools, I think that if we are ever to work this as a real world monitoring tool, we need at least to be able to analyze data using the same tools. But in the meantime, we are making efforts towards making it mainstream, and we already have a manual that we provide to all of the contractors hired by Vale who are collecting material for our studies. So with that, I'll wrap up. I'll just have a number of people to thank. I don't have time to go through each one of them, but I would like to thank everyone who helped us conduct this work. And most of this was funded by Vale, but we also received funds from other agencies in Brazil and abroad. So I'll finish here and then pass it on to Dirk for the next talk. Thank you very much.
Hi there. Sorry for disappearing and appearing all the time. I hope you can hear me all right.
Yes.
Perfect. I'm going to switch to the presentation in a minute. So when I was thinking about what to present here, I thought, okay, what can I go through? And it will be a mixture of things you probably, for sure, many of you have heard about, but I use this as a backbone to show where the technology is right now and where I see issues, or at least things that need to be overcome when you really want to establish methods that are related to eDNA use and metabarcoding and all that, when you really want to go to the next step and implementing it into some sort of a regulatory context or into your day-to-day routine. So let me just get up and switch. There's no need to do a slide share. I hope our studio works. Here we go. All right. So, I hope you can see that. I'm not sure. I'm still seeing Guillermo's thing all the time. Can everybody see the slide?
Not on full screen, but I see it.
It's weird. Can you? I think if you switch off your microphone, you should. It should be popping up because then I'm the only user. Hopefully, yeah. Here we go. And for some reason, it's flipped. That is a new one.
I spotlighted it for everyone, which raised it up for me. I don't know if that's helped everyone.
So you can see it. It's not mirror image for you?
Yeah, it's fine for us. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Then it's just for me watching it. That's okay. I can live with that. That's fine. So what I'm trying to give is a primer to the current technology in metabarcoding and environmental DNA research. What I'm using is the metabarcoding process as a backbone to go through that. Because to be honest, don't take that the wrong way, for me, an eDNA sample is yet another sample I put into this process. Of course, there's also, and I will talk about that a little, branching off, if we're not talking about using sequencing technology with eDNA samples, all the assays that are species specific that are out there, I will talk about that in a bit, because the community working with eDNA assays has a few advantages and went ahead with a few things that the rest of the community might at some point will have to follow. So that is, and most of you will be familiar, the regular normal way of going through metabarcoding samples. And I will go through that and use that as one to go through every single step there. So of course you have the normal barcode on a meta barcoding approach with bulk samples. And you see a number of examples here as photos. In the upper right is probably the instrument that our institute in Guelph is currently most used for, and that's the malaise trap. We're using it for two things. We're using it for the meta barcoding process. Once we are confident we have a reference library in place to really do studies to determine long-term changes, site differences, you name it. All the other tools we use as well, but this one is the main one. But we also use a lot of malaise trap data from places in the world where people haven't been doing a lot of reference library work in order to build up the reference library for future projects. And that is one of probably the core issue. Whenever you work with any kind of approach, and it doesn't matter if it's an eDNA sample or not, if you want to do something that goes beyond the I found so and so many OTUs and that changed over time or whatever, then we need reference libraries. And that's the one thing where we will always be sort of complaining for the next number of years, that there is gaps in there, and metabarcoding will lead you to even more new discoveries. And then the question is, how do I get back to an original sample? Because most metabarcoding protocols I know are consumptive, meaning they destroy specimens, which is a bit of an issue. but there are ways around that. But I'm not talking so much about that. Try to give you other examples, and many of you will be familiar with some of them. Environmental sampling, and clearly here it's dominated currently by water samples there, and anything that people can obtain through that. There's a lot of work done in fish, but also with invertebrates and everything else. So what you see here on the right is pretty much from the easiest technology, that just holding a bottle or something in the water, take that to the lab and start filtering, all the way to very modern samplers, like the one marine sampler that you see there as a prototype I've developed by Mbari in the US, where that can be brought on the high seas with a ship. So all these different types of sampling technologies are out there. The question is only there. Usually, do you take a water sample? Can you afford to bring tons of water back to the lab and do the filtering there? Or do you do the filtering on site? There's a lot of tools out there currently, like the backpack you see in that image, the Andy, where you have filtering unit and everything in one thing. In addition to that, they have, the same company has developed a small thing. I hope you can see that in the right. It's pretty much a small package you can carry around with a small battery unit, and this does the filtering and pumping for you. It's meant as a citizen science sampler, and we actually tested two of them. They're quite easy to use and fairly affordable, I'd say. So, and then of course, there's lots of other ways of sampling eDNA, sediment. You've probably seen some of the hype around air samples and the ability to actually determine species with that. There will be lots more of those technologies, and I don't think there's a huge issue. People's creativity is quite well there. And as I said, they seem to be all technology available in all price ranges, and everyone can participate without any boundaries there. When it comes to bulk samples, the most common approach is really just dry them, and do something with it before I remove debris and anything else. People usually try not to have too much sediment in there. There's a lot of inhibition that can come with sediments. Sometimes it's just a question if it's feasible or not. And that, now I'm talking about usually freshwater samples with kick nets or so on. Of course, a Malay strap bottle is only full with arthropods and nothing else. That is relatively easy. You can try to extract the DNA directly from the ethanol. Our experience is that it comes with loss. What you can do is take your entire sample and subject it to a shortened lysis stage, which means you keep most of the animals in there intact as long as there are some sort of hard body ones. So with external skeletons, that gets a little tricky with soft body ones, they're gone. These are the methods out there for bulk sampling and for eDNA samples. I think preaching to a lot of people here, you usually filter them on site or in the lab. That's a decision that mostly has to do with practicalities. Both is possible. I should say that there's a few systems out there where you have a self-preserving filter system. So you really can buy a complete set of filter that you either use with one of those pumps I was showing, or you can take a larger syringe and then pump the water you sampled through it yourself until you can't do it anymore because the filter starts clogging over time. And there's different sets of self-preserving filters, so you don't have to do much in order to keep them in a small Ziploc bag and bring them home. So it's relatively simple to use. As I said, we're doing it already with citizen scientists. They use the syringe. So it's so simple to use that you can actually task people that are not experts with the sampling for you. And there's other groups and companies like in Great Britain where they do the same thing. They task other people with it. So in terms of the extraction itself, there's a discussion going on. Some people prefer to grind the filters to a pulp and then start their usual DNA extraction approach and everything else. It's very similar to what you do with bulk samples. But what I found is that it's most common, and that's what we mostly do, is submerge the filters in the lysis and use the lysate. The argument against it was usually, you don't get enough DNA or less than you could have. But we found out it does really not make a big difference. And it's way easier for handling. especially if you don't need to grind and find some sort of a beat beater. If you don't have one in the lab, it does its trick. It's not a big deal. The only thing you often see is when you put in your lysate, it all disappears because the filter is just sucking it up, but a little bit of centrifuging on the table and you've done everything you need. Next step, and that's the barcoding or the meta barcoding avenue. I was talking about, if you're going down the sequencing route, you often do, or mostly have seen, two-step PCRs. So the first PCR uses the target primer, most used ones, CO1, but when we talk about eDNA, 12S for certain vertebrates is used. The DNA barcoding community slowly coming around to realize that CO1 doesn't solve all the problems, especially when you're doing eDNA research of fishes or other vertebrates. 12S is way better. Don't have to deal with as much bacteria contamination as with other markers. I think I've heard that before in the discussion also, and I can attest to the very same phenomenon. CO1 and 16S are probably the worst when it comes to these kinds of samples. 16S, yeah, CO1 and that. And then PCR2 is usually to add sample specific tags and instrument adapters to it, depending on what kind of sequencing you're going to plan on doing. There's a lot of recent studies where people look into bringing those two processes into one, and it's possible. We do that for some of our lab routines where we have a single PCR approach just to save time and costs in order to prepare the samples for the very same thing. I'm branching out a little bit because I have to, for sake of completeness and for depending on what the type of studies you're doing, because if you are just looking for a particular species, invasive species, protected ones, things that are rare, then you might want to consider eDNA assays using a qPCR approach, as it's shown here. The one thing that there is, it's nice because it will save you eventually all the sequencing costs for individual samples. The only upfront cost you have to invest in is the development of a marker that suits your needs. So one that is species specific or can distinguish between a small number of species and also covers the entire variation range within a species, so between different populations. So currently most assays, and you can see that in that one graph here with a big on the right with a big blue block there in the histogram, is mostly for fish, but it has been shown for other vertebrates as well. So there's lots of assays out there. Most of them use qPCR, others use standard PCR methods, which is possible too. The other thing that's slowly coming in, depends highly on availability and budget, is digital droplet PCR using a very similar approach. As I said, that community is slightly ahead of the ones that use meta barcoding simply because they realized one thing, that there is a million different protocols out there. And all these assays are very difficult to compare. And there's a paper by a postdoc of mine, Bettina Thalinger, and a lot of other colleagues around the world that looked at a lot of studies in order to find out if there might be a way of calibrating all these studies, bringing them together and find an ideal way of conducting these assays. People have very, very different approaches to do them. And that is a problem we're facing in all of what we're doing. Probably from my perspective, the most big bottleneck, it's actually a roadblock. If you wanna have a standardized method for any kind of regulatory use, you need standards. And it's difficult if your community is so different in its approaches. And this is when it comes to eDNA studies right now, because we're still sort of in the last bit of the phase, let's try out what works. We're not having the nice consistency we would need. Sequencing, just briefly, that is really just what's available to you. For the most part, if we're talking meta barcode eDNA studies, then we're looking at the upper part here with the short read instruments. Unless you are looking at a MinION from Oxford Nanopore, which is of course a long read instrument, but it comes with its own little quirks and the little issues that have to do with its relatively high error rate. Although I have to say they got better and better, and people have been getting better in developing bioinformatic tools that help to overcome these problems. and also lab protocols that help to make the MinION a competitive instrument, because most of the time what you will see is anything from out of the house of Illumina, mostly MiSeq data, but then lots of other things. The HiSeq is still listed, although it's a discontinued instrument. They're not going to sell it anymore. We're just lucky that they keep selling the chemistry and it's compatible. And I guess that will go on for a while. But of course, they promote their new instrument, the NovaSeq, but that is usually one. Well, let's face it, reality is most of us will make use, if possible, of a sequencing facility, of a company that offers that for commercial use. We do the same for NovaSeq, for example. Although we have sequencers from the other categories, we do not have such a big one in-house because the upfront investment cost is still too high. But it's easy to obtain something usually in the vicinity, and more instruments are widely distributed in the world. So it's becoming more and more accessible. It's just a matter of the pricing, of course. It's really the dimensions of your studies will dictate what is probably the best instrument. And if you are on a low budget and you probably happen to own a MinION, yeah, why not? You can actually do decent meta barcoding with it. We've shown that. Of course, your sample sizes are probably smaller, but you can still work with it. The bioinformatics, that is also the other part of what I would say is a bit of the Wild West, because everybody seemed to have a slightly different approach to it. There's tools for every step I could show here in this graph. Usually things in bioinformatics and processing data and meta barcoding, eDNA meta barcoding, or any other sample meta barcoding, is either instrument specific, not much you can do about it, a lot of proprietary software involved in that. The next thing is then, of course, the universal stuff where you do all the filtering, denoising, clustering if you want to, then taxon assignment. So that is one that highly depends on the state of your reference library. But then, as I said, there's a million ways of going through these steps. You can skip some, you do some filtering steps earlier than others. Later on, the discussion currently is, do I cluster or do I not cluster when I want to do taxonomic assignment? There's this ongoing discussion said, either you use clusters or you do ASVs or ESVs, and then assign them to taxonomy. Again, it's a bit of a hindrance if you think about a standardization that actually gets you into the regulatory space, where things have to be set in one way or the other. The community is on the way trying to do that. In Europe, for example, the big DNA Aquanet project was actually about all these different aspects of it, bringing them together, and then also having in the discussion the decision makers and the companies that offer that. So to come up with ways to exactly bring eDNA work into the professional space. So as I said, there's a multitude of tools out there. Here, just a quick example of this is all what I was able to find, which is currently still functional when you want to do your taxonomic assignment. And the question is, how on earth am I going to choose the right one? And we did one study and trying to find that, and already discovered the one of the biggest problems is that half of them don't really have anybody looking after the program. So after a while, they will probably disappear because they're not platform compatible anymore or anything like that. So there's a lot of coming and going between all these different taxonomic assessment methods. And as I said, that's just one part of the entire bioinformatics pipeline. So an incomplete list of limitations. I will not go through all of them in detail. I haven't touched on one thing, which is always the discussion. You're doing these kinds of studies right now, no matter what your input sample is, an eDNA filtrate or a bulk sample. The one thing what we're really after, and it can be done only a limited, is determined abundance. Although it's very often important to have abundance data, it's very difficult to actually get there, or downright impossible with the methods we're having. And then with other things, there's primer bias, of course, there's PCR inhibitors that play a big role. Then what I said already, there's way too many different protocols. Just two solutions to two problems. So the primer and abundance problems probably in the future could be solved by something like using metagenomics. The idea is you skip the PCR, which is one of the problem zones in the entire process because of PCR bias. disadvantage right now. With metagenomics, you have an even smaller reference library, and you don't have, and you have higher costs associated with it. It's not that you can just do a metagenomic run one after the other, but there's certainly promising things out there. There's also in relation with newer experiments people are doing, we're doing that too, is looking not after eDNA, but after eRNA, because we're interested in cellular processes where RNA probably gives you an even more detailed answer, but that comes with new challenges. Just before we solved all the eDNA challenges, we're trying to come up with new challenges there. So metagenomics might be a way to solve the primer and abundance problem, but I wouldn't say we're there yet. And then the protocol diversity issue, there's something that's the same study I've shown with the people that looked into eDNA assays to just bring the community together. And this project was born out of that DNA AquaNet in Europe, where everybody sat around the table, we actually have to first look at what is out there in terms of all the assays that people are using. And then they looked at what probably coming up with a scale that shows how reproductive, how inclusive some of the studies are, and come up with a weighing scheme. Not saying anything is bad, but just weigh in terms of what information is available. Can it be completely, is it completely reproducible or not? Which is probably one of the most important things. So slowly going towards a unification of what is out there and trying to come up with something that helps more towards standardization in the future. And well, there's only one way around the reference library problem. We just have to go through on what, for example, here, International Barcode of Life does it. Really just having a few projects dedicated to get as many marker information as possible for as many species as possible. Of course, DNA barcoding will focus on CO1, but there's already people that do the very same for the alternative markers that are currently used in eDNA studies. And we will have to continue that, especially in areas where we don't know a lot. And currently our only answer in a study is, okay, there's 500 OTUs. That's all we can come up with. So that was me. Thank you very much. And I'm, as far as I understand, we have the questions then later on.
Yes, thank you so much, Dirk. So now we can move on to Diego if he's already there, ready to go. Yes, it's with you, Diego.
Oi, Guilherme. Olá a todos, bom dia. Como o Daniel falou, o Guilherme comentou também, eu vou fazer a apresentação em português. Vou apresentar aqui a tela, ver se ela está aparecendo. Todos estão vendo a tela?
Está ok.
Ok. Bom, então, sou Diego, sou analista ambiental do Instituto de Comandos e Conservação da Biodiversidade, que é uma das autarquias federais brasileiras que tratam de meio ambiente. Eu trabalho no Centro Nacional de Pesquisa e Conservação de Cavernas, o CECAV, e vou falar um pouco, sobre como essas tecnologias que já foram tão bem exploradas aí pelos palestrantes anteriores, do eDNA, o DNA ambiental e o metabarcode, eles podem melhorar, ajudar a melhorar, na verdade, o licenciamento ambiental de empreendimentos e atividades que podem impactar cavernas aqui do Brasil. Tá? Então, como as tecnologias já foram muito bem abordadas, eu vou aproveitar para melhorar o entendimento e falar um pouco, não só sobre cavernas, sobre o processo de licenciamento ambiental também. Então, o que é uma caverna? Para falar de caverna, a gente precisa falar de ambiente subterrâneo. A caverna é só uma parte desse ambiente. Então, a gente tem um ambiente superficial, logo abaixo a gente tem o que pode chamar de solo. Isso é uma apresentação bem geral, na verdade, dependendo da litologia que ocorre na região, isso pode mudar, mas de maneira geral isso acontece. A gente tem esse meio endógeno, que quem poderia chamar de solo, de maneira simplificada. Essa interface de contato entre o solo e a rocha, a gente costuma chamar de epicarste. né, que é também um dos compartimentos do ambiente subterrâneo. E abaixo do epicarso a gente tem o que a gente chama de ambiente hipógeo, né, que são comumente chamadas de cavernas, né? E o que a gente tem de conceito de caverna, até do ponto de vista legal, é um conceito antropogênico, né? Ou seja, seria qualquer espaço, né, formado em rocha, naturalmente, acessível ao ser humano, né? Então a gente tem o que seria uma caverna típica, né? Só que, como eu falei, a caverna é só uma parte de uma ampla rede de espaços subterrâneos, né? De espaços variados, de tamanhos variados, que podem ser preenchidos tanto por água como por ar, né? E o que é caverna para o ser humano, né, é caverna para os seres cavernícolas, né, na sua maior parte formada por invertebrados, e também essa grande rede de espaços menores, formados por micro, mesocavernas e tamanhos variados, elas podem ser acessadas por esses organismos, né, podem para transitar entre uma macrocaverna e outra, ou até mesmo ser o principal hábitat de várias dessas espécies. Então, se a gente continua falando de ambiente subterrâneo, né, a gente também tem diferentes zonas, né? Primeiro você tem uma zona de entrada, que é aquela zona onde você tem a luz do sol entrando livremente, né? Você vai ter uma temperatura variável acompanhando o ambiente externo, você vai ter crescimento de vegetação, fotossíntese, produção primária, isso tudo. Depois a gente vai ter uma zona de penumbra, né, que vai ter menos luz, vai acompanhar menos a variação ambiental, então você já tem temperatura e umidade menos variáveis do que o ambiente externo e um crescimento mínimo de vegetação. Na zona afótica, né, que é comumente associada aos ambientes subterrâneos, a gente não tem luz nenhuma e a temperatura ela é constante, geralmente acompanha, né, a média do ambiente externo, a média normal do ambiente externo, e a umidade ela tende a saturação, né, um ambiente bastante úmido. Se a gente fizer uma associação, né, dessas zonas com o nível de adaptação ao ambiente subterrâneo das diferentes espécies que ocorrem em cavernas, a gente pode ter, primeiro, órgãos acidentais, que não têm adaptação a nenhum ambiente subterrâneo, né? Geralmente são acidentais por conta disso, eles entram, principalmente nas zonas afóticas, geralmente não conseguem sair. A gente tem os troglóxenos, né, que são aqueles que, apesar de ter algum tipo de adaptação ao ambiente subterrâneo, eles ainda precisam sair em algum momento para completar o ciclo de vida, né? Os morcegos são os principais representantes. A gente tem os troglófilos, que são aqueles que têm um nível de adaptação maior, e eles já podem completar o ciclo de vida tanto dentro como fora do ambiente subterrâneo. E a gente tem os troglobos, né, que são aqueles organismos que já estão tão adaptados ao ambiente subterrâneo que eles não conseguem formar populações viáveis no ambiente externo. Tá? E aí eles têm esse jeitão, né, de bicho de caverna, que a gente costuma dizer, que são os bichos sem olho, geralmente não tem pigmentação, todo tipo de estrutura sensorial que não depende da luz, ela está aumentada, né, também tem adaptações fisiológicas, reprodutivas, né, basicamente que tem a ver também com, não só com esse ambiente muito mais constante, como também com geralmente uma falta, né, de recursos tróficos. E essas adaptações, ao mesmo tempo em que fazem com que os bichos vivam muito bem no ambiente subterrâneo, eles levam também uma perda na capacidade de dispersão desses organismos. Então, isso favorece o isolamento de linhagens, né, e a especiação no ambiente subterrâneo. Então, os pestroglobos geralmente têm distribuição restrita, né, são endêmicos, né, apresentando muitas vezes endemismos extremos, independente dessa escala de avaliação. Então, de maneira simplificada, os acidentais não podem entrar, os troglóxenos precisam sair, os troglófilos podem entrar e sair livremente e os troglóbios não podem sair do ambiente subterrâneo. Então, essas características dos troglóbios, né, elas são gerais e a gente pode exemplificar isso também com as espécies que ocorrem no Brasil, né? Das espécies descritas que estão atualmente sendo avaliadas, né, num processo que o ICMBio também que coordena de avaliação da fauna brasileira ameaçada de extinção, esse processo iniciou em 2018, então em 2018 a gente tinha 145 espécies troglóbias oficialmente descritas no Brasil, apesar da gente já conhecer atualmente mais de 1.000, né, mas somente 145 estão descritas. Destas, 90% pode ser classificado em alguma categoria de ameaça, né? 27 delas vulnerável, 39 em perigo, 64 criticamente ameaçadas. E 85 espécies, mais da metade, ela ocorre apenas em uma caverna ou em um sistema de cavernas interconectadas. Então, é o que a gente chama de endemismo extremo, realmente. E isso, obviamente, né, tem implicações tanto na conservação como no licenciamento ambiental. Quantas cavernas a gente tem no Brasil? Né? Atualmente são mais de 21 mil cavernas, né? A maioria em rochas carbonáticas, calcários principalmente, né? Sílice clássicas como arenito e também as ferruginosas, como o Guilherme também já falou. Né? Praticamente metade dessas cavernas está no estado de Minas Gerais, seguidos por Pará, Bahia e Rio Grande do Norte, com mais de 1000 cavernas cada um. E a mineração é a atividade conflitante mais comum. Né? Mais da metade, quase metade, na verdade, das cavernas conhecidas estão em polígonos ou com requerimento ou com concessão de lavra na Agência Nacional de Mineração. Obviamente, estar em um polígono minerário não quer dizer que a caverna esteja diretamente afetada, né? Mas é um indício de potencial impacto. Então, de acordo com isso que eu falei, né, a gente tem uma legislação ambiental no Brasil voltada especificamente para cavernas, né? Então, o licenciamento ambiental desses empreendimentos que potencialmente impactam cavernas é baseado em um estudo multidisciplinar chamado análise de relevância. Né? Então, baseado na análise de atributos tanto físicos, biológicos, socioeconômicos, histórico, culturais, essas cavernas são classificadas como de máxima, alta, média ou baixa relevância. Né? As principais são as cavernas de máxima relevância. Né? E aí elas e a sua área de influência, eu vou falar um pouco mais, na verdade, muito sobre a área de influência mais um pouco à frente, elas não podem sofrer o que a gente chama de impactos negativos irreversíveis. Né? E aí essas são as características que uma caverna tem que ter, né, para ela ser considerada de máxima relevância. Tendo um desses atributos, ela já pode ser classificada. Gênese único ou rara, morfologia única, dimensões notáveis em extensão, área ou volume, espeleotemas únicos, isolamento geográfico, né? E aí a gente tem os atributos biológicos, que é ser a caverna ser considerada um abrigo essencial, né, para a preservação de populações geneticamente viáveis de animais em risco de extinção, desde que oficialmente, né, estejam presentes em alguma lista oficial de ameaça, de espécies ameaçadas, ser um hábito essencial para a preservação de populações geneticamente viáveis de espécies de troglóbios endêmicos ou relictos, né, hábitat de troglóbio raro, interações ecológicas únicas, né? Cavidade testemunho, né? Que eu vou falar um pouco mais sobre o que é isso, e destacada relevância histórica, cultural ou religiosa. Tá? Essas são as cavernas de relevância máxima, os atributos que levam a caverna à relevância máxima, e elas não podem sofrer nenhum tipo de impacto. As cavernas de alta relevância, né? Como aquelas que possuem troglóbios que não são considerados nem raros, nem endêmicos ou relictos, elas podem sofrer impactos negativos e irreversíveis, tá? Mas, né? Então, como eu falei, as de máxima relevância, se o empreendimento quiser, né, precisar, na verdade, impactar uma caverna de máxima relevância ou sua área de influência, né, ele não vai ocorrer. A viabilidade ambiental dele não existe e, em teoria, o órgão responsável pelo licenciamento não pode emitir a licença. Se a caverna for classificada como de alta relevância, né, e o empreendimento for causar impactos, ele pode, tá? Desde que, né, você tenha a preservação ad eternum, né, de duas outras cavernas de relevância alta com atributos similares àquela que sofreu os impactos, e essas duas cavernas elas passam a ser consideradas cavernas testemunha, e aí automaticamente elas são elevadas à relevância máxima. Tá? Então, é mais ou menos assim que funciona. Então, o 2-1, como a gente chama, né, que é a conservação de duas outras cavernas de relevância alta para cada uma impactada, ela está inserida no que a gente chama de compensação espeleológica, né? Compensação ambiental por impactos em cavernas. Então, as de média e de baixa são compensações que não envolvem a conservação de outras cavernas, então quem tiver mais interesse pode entrar em contato ou procurar na legislação, mas eu não vou tratar nessa apresentação. E eu falei muito de área de influência, né? Então, o que é que a legislação brasileira chama de área de influência de cavernas? É aquela área, né, que compreende os elementos bióticos, abióticos, superficiais ou subterrâneos, necessária para manter o equilíbrio ecológico e a integridade física do ambiente subterrâneo, do ambiente da caverna. Tá? Então, geralmente, como é que esses estudos para definir a área de influência são feitos? Então, além do estudo de análise de relevância, precisa ser feito um estudo de área de influência. Você só sabe se a caverna vai ser impactada se você souber a área necessária do entorno para preservar aquela caverna. Então, são levados em consideração aspectos físicos, né? Os mais comuns, por exemplo, são os estudos sismográficos, né? Você verifica realmente se tem algum risco, né, de abalar a estrutura física daquela caverna. E a parte ambiental, ela é verificada com base, basicamente, né, na conectividade entre ambientes subterrâneos adjacentes e na manutenção do aporte de nutrientes para a caverna. Né? Como eu falei, as cavernas, de maneira geral, são afóticas, elas não têm produção primária, né, não têm fotossíntese, então todos os recursos, basicamente, né, praticamente todos os recursos para a fauna residente ali, elas têm que vir de fora. Né? Então, você manter o aporte de nutrientes é muito importante para manter o equilíbrio ecológico. Né? Então, a conectividade ela pode ser definida com base, né, em traçadores químicos, né, para as cavernas que possuem hidrologia ativa. Né? E, com relação aos aspectos biológicos, nas cavernas onde o guano de morcego ele é considerado um nutriente importante, né, a área de influência ela pode ser medida com base na área domiciliar dos morcegos, ou seja, na área necessária, né, para aquele morcego conseguir comida, se reproduzir, por aí vai. Nas cavernas secas, a gente também pode falar de conectividade subterrânea, usando o que a gente chama de traçadores biológicos, né, que são os troglobes. Se os troglobes não podem ocorrer fora, não é que eles não podem ocorrer fora, mas eles não desenvolvem populações viáveis fora do ambiente subterrâneo, e eles ocorrem a populações em cavernas diferentes, né, você imagina que haja uma conexão e que essas espécies troglobes possam transitar entre essas macrocavernas por espaços menores. Então, você usar a distribuição de troglobes também é uma forma de você definir a área de influência. Tá? Então, onde é que estão as principais lacunas do ponto de vista biológico? A gente precisa saber, né, quem são os troglobes, né, quantas espécies são e onde elas estão. Então, basicamente, identificar, delimitar e avaliar a distribuição dessas espécies troglobes. E, além disso, definir qual é a área necessária para manter a integridade física e o equilíbrio ecológico dessas cavernas. Ou seja, definir corretamente, satisfatoriamente, a área de influência, né? Como eu já falei anteriormente. A gente pode perceber que as lacunas de conhecimento que a gente tem para o licenciamento são basicamente as mesmas, né, para a biologia subterrânea de maneira geral, né? Então, a gente tem diversos impedimentos, né? O mais comum dele é o impedimento taxonômico, um impedimento liniano, como já é conhecido, né? Que é muito complicado de trabalhar em caverna, porque é um ambiente com prevalência de espécies crípticas, né? Que são aquelas que não podem ser identificadas com base somente em taxonomia tradicional, morfológica. Né? Onde essas espécies estão, né? Já que há uma prevalência de espécies crípticas, espécies endêmicas, né? A maior parte desses ambientes subterrâneos ele não é acessível, ele é difícil de amostrar, a não ser que por meios indiretos. Mesmo as cavernas, que são acessíveis ao ser humano, muitas delas são desafiadoras, não é qualquer pessoa que consegue tanto acessar como amostrar satisfatoriamente o ambiente subterrâneo. Né? Quão abundantes essas espécies são, né? E como é que você estima a abundância, né, em um ambiente complicado como esse? E as espécies troglóbias, normalmente, elas têm baixa abundância também. Né? Então, os impedimentos são os mesmos. Com uma falta de informação, na verdade, informação insuficiente que a gente tem, é inevitável o uso do princípio da precaução. Né? Então, é um princípio que rege basicamente a legislação ambiental brasileira e na falta de evidências, né, você geralmente tem que usar esse princípio. Então, para que a gente use cada vez menos o princípio da precaução, a gente precisa avançar cada vez mais no conhecimento. Né? Então, falar um pouco mais sobre espécies crípticas, né? Então, como eu falei, se a espécie é troglóbia, né, ela não pode ocorrer no ambiente externo, não desenvolve populações viáveis no ambiente externo. Então, se elas ocorrem em cavernas diferentes, você imagina que tem uma conectividade subterrânea, que é representada por uma conectividade no ambiente terrestre e no ambiente aquático também. Tá? Então, as duas cavernas fariam parte do sistema e, para você definir, você teria aí uma espécie troglóbia terrestre, uma espécie troglóbia aquática, por exemplo, e as duas cavernas estariam interconectadas, seria um sistema. Né? Então, elas deveriam ser consideradas uma coisa só. Né? Então, o meio entre essas duas cavernas teria que fazer parte da área de influência, por exemplo, das duas. Né? Mas imagine só que isso aqui é uma situação ancestral, não é uma situação atual. Né? E houve uma mudança climática, por exemplo, como que aconteceu aqui na nossa Caatinga, na região nordeste do Brasil. Né? Então, você não tem mais essa conectividade, por diminuição da umidade, as raízes não estão mais ocorrendo aí, você não tem mais tanto recurso, então você não tem disponibilidade de hábitat mais onde antes tinha, e essa conectividade biológica não ocorre mais. Da mesma forma, no ambiente aquático, você teve, por exemplo, um rebaixamento do aquífero, né? Então, áreas que estavam ligadas ao nível freático não estão mais atualmente. Mas essas espécies, né, que você imagina que seja uma espécie só, uma terrestre e uma aquática, elas continuam ocorrendo nessas duas cavernas, né? Então, o que pode acontecer? Na verdade, você pode ter populações ou espécies críticas dependendo do tempo de isolamento, né? E como é que a gente identifica isso? Como é que a gente pode fazer no caso de empreendimento, né? Então, vou falar um pouco de um estudo que foi desenvolvido aqui no Rio Grande do Norte, né? São uma região com mais de 70 espécies troglobias, é uma região, do ponto de vista biológico, das mais relevantes no Brasil. Apenas 4 dessas espécies têm distribuição considerada ampla, né? Então, segue esse padrão. A grande maioria ocorre em apenas uma caverna ou poucas cavernas próximas, né? Então, nós avaliamos todas essas 4 espécies e descobrimos que apenas uma é amplamente distribuída. Vocês podem ver aqui, né? Aqui é a região oeste, então essa espécie, um isópito aquático, um cirulonídeo, né, ocorre em toda essa região. Então, com base em análises filogenéticas e filogeográficas, trata-se de realmente uma espécie única. Mas as outras 3 espécies, né, uma outra espécie do mesmo grupo, cirulonídeo, né, não é uma única espécie, são 3, na verdade, espécies críticas. E se a gente for fazer a avaliação do estado de conservação com base nos critérios da IUCN, se fosse uma só, a gente teria uma espécie em perigo, né, avaliando individualmente a cada uma das espécies críticas, a gente teria uma menos preocupante e 2 criticamente ameaçadas. Então, isso também interfere com o nível da ameaça, né? Mesma coisa para uma espécie de anfípoda também aquática, né? Em vez de uma espécie, a gente tem 5, na verdade. E para a única espécie terrestre com ampla distribuição. Imaginava-se que fosse apenas uma espécie, na verdade, são 7, né? Então, a identificação de complexo de espécies críticas, né? Complexo de espécies, na verdade, em espécies troglobias é frequente. Então, as áreas cascas, né? No caso dos carbonatos ou pseudocascas, no caso de ferro e outras litologias, elas geralmente são naturalmente fragmentadas, né? E permitem uma conectividade subterrânea somente em escala local, entre cavernas próximas, principalmente as espécies terrestres, né? Mas mesmo em espécies aquáticas, que podem migrar, por exemplo, por meio de aquíferos subterrâneos, o lençol freático, por exemplo, é comum a identificação de espécies críticas, geralmente distribuídas de acordo com padrões de drenagem, por exemplo, microbacias, que foi o que a gente identificou nesse estudo, tá? Então, diante desse cenário, como é que a gente pode melhorar o licenciamento ambiental com essas tecnologias que a gente tem, né? Então, o primeiro passo seria no próprio estudo de impacto ambiental, né? Que inclui os estudos espeleológicos. E a gente responderia as mesmas perguntas, né? Onde estão os troglóbios? Quantos são? Onde eles estão? E qual área necessária, ou seja, a área de influência, para manter o equilíbrio ecológico e a integridade física das cavernas, né? Então, essas análises básicas, filogenéticas e filogeográficas, utilizando tanto um como vários marcadores, ou mesmo sequenciamento NGS, né, elas podem identificar essas questões, né, de forma complementar aos inventários já tradicionalmente feitos, né? Então, a gente identificaria, delimitaria essas linhagens, sua distribuição, e apontaria também indícios de conectividade biológica subterrânea para definição de áreas de influência. E onde é que entraria o IDNA, né, o DNA ambiental e o metabarcode, né? Ele também, de forma complementar, serviria para fazer uma caracterização prévia dessas comunidades, né? Os estudos iniciais, eles também serviriam para padronizar esses procedimentos e protocolos. A gente já viu que é muito importante a padronização para ter resultados confiáveis, né? Poderia ser feita, por exemplo, a análise da dieta de morcegos, onde, né, essas colônias são importantes para manter o equilíbrio ecológico da caverna, né? E a gente, com base nesses estudos, poderia também melhorar, né, os bancos de dados de referência. A gente já viu também que isso é muito importante para identificar corretamente as espécies lá na frente, como resultado final do metabarcoding, por exemplo. Então, isso já foi feito. A gente tem diversos estudos, né, que avaliam tanto a comunidade, né, subterrânea de maneira geral, e eu quero chamar a atenção para esse estudo, né, publicado em 2020, né, lá na Austrália, em que, além de fazer uma avaliação da comunidade subterrânea de maneira geral, eles também fizeram análise de similaridade, tanto com base na comunidade como com base em características físico-químicas da água, né? E com base nisso, eles estimaram conectividade subterrânea. Estaria aplicável, por exemplo, a definição de áreas de influência, né? De maneira geral, os estudos eles são direcionados para espécies-alvo, geralmente espécies-alvo, espécies raras, espécies ameaçadas, né? Como é o caso da maioria dos troglobos. E eles podem ser realizados tanto durante o diagnóstico, né, quando já se sabe que espécies de interesse eles ocorrem na área do prendimento, ou potencialmente pode ocorrer, como durante o monitoramento. Esse é um estudo, por exemplo, com Proteus anguinus, né, que é a salamandra, a primeira espécie de trogobe descrita no mundo, lá no Cacho Dinárico, na Europa. E além de identificar, além de confirmar, né, a ocorrência dessa espécie nos locais, identificar o DNA nos locais onde já sabidamente a espécie ocorre, foram identificados outros locais que a espécie não pode ser identificada de maneira tradicional, né? Isso também foi feito para anfípodes, por exemplo, para peixes, né? Mais uma vez na Austrália. Então a gente tem geralmente o mesmo padrão desses estudos. Você amostra vários estudos, você confirma a existência deles, dessas espécies nos locais onde ele pode ser coletado fisicamente, e você identifica outros locais onde o DNA ele é detectado dessas espécies. Foi feito também, por exemplo, com essa espécie de lagosta, trogóbia, também, que ocorre nos Estados Unidos, o padrão é o mesmo, tá? Então, tudo isso você pode fazer previamente, né? Durante a fase de estudos ambientais ainda. E aí depois, né, quando as licenças saem, então o que você pode fazer é monitorar, monitorar e monitorar. Né? Guilherme falou do caso de S11D, né, que é uma mina de ferro da Vale, lá na região de Carajás, no Pará. E esse monitoramento, utilizando todas essas tecnologias associadas, claro, aos inventários e monitoramentos que já são amplamente utilizados, ela é possível principalmente no caso de grandes empreendimentos, né? Então, alteração nas comunidades, né? Detecção de DNA de espécies de interesse, monitoramento da ocorrência dessas espécies, possíveis alterações na dieta de morcegos que podem estar relacionadas, por exemplo, com alterações na composição e na abundância dessas comunidades de morcegos, né? Que você pode relacionar, por exemplo, com o avanço de uma cava, né? Então, a gente pode ver, por exemplo, essa imagem de 2013, né? Essa é a imagem de 2016. Então, esses pontinhos vermelhos aí são as cavernas. Então, a gente tem diversos impactos ocorrendo em cavernas de maneira autorizada, em cavernas, por exemplo, de relevância alta, né? Que já que o impacto está autorizado, você pode manter o monitoramento até a supressão da cavidade. Então, essas informações com base em cavernas que vão ser suprimidas, elas podem ser utilizadas para refinar, né, o monitoramento e a definição de área de influência de cavernas de relevância máxima, por exemplo. Então, uma imagem de 2017, né, e uma imagem mais ou menos atual de como é que está o empreendimento hoje, né? Então, de maneira geral, o que eu diria é que as tecnologias de DNA e metabarcoding, elas idealmente devem ser integradas aos métodos tradicionais de inventário e monitoramento, né? Então, ela permite que não só a gente some os benefícios de ambas as formas, né? As maneiras de se estudar um ambiente subterrâneo, como você também não fica com os pontos fracos de uma abordagem unificada, né? Então, eu acho que a palavra-chave aqui é integração. Integração de métodos tradicionais com as novas tecnologias. Então, aí as referências. Muito obrigado. Peço desculpa por ter passado um pouco do tempo e estou à disposição para os questionamentos.
Thank you very much, Diego. This was excellent. And I think you gave us a very nice perspective from the environmental agency on how to deal with these issues. So I'll start with two questions that we have in the chat. The first one is from Luani. I'll answer in English, Luani, for the benefit of Dirk and everyone else. And I think Diego is also comfortable with listening. She's asking if we have monitored fauna in Carajás and if we have results. So yes, we have several ways of works for monitoring fauna with fish. Especially, we have some interesting results in what we see that the classification of fish using traditional methods was way out there. And so we are reclassifying the fish, and also we could see quite a bit more than the traditional technologies could. And also we have some papers published on using insects as a way of monitoring land recuperation. So we can classify land recuperation according to the insects that appeared. And also we were able to detect mammals by looking at what insects fed on. So that's was also really interesting, but there's a whole lot more. And the other question from Gabriel is about the monitoring ferruginous caves, because they are so highly endemic. So what about the reference database? So that's a real issue, Gabriel. But we are tackling that by collecting samples and doing the DNA barcode for each of these. The problem there, for instance, with some taxonomic groups is that the universal primes do not work for them. So we have to do next gen sequencing and assemble at least a mitogenome to get them to be able to design primers specific for these animals. So it's quite challenging, but we are tackling this. And we did actually with Diego quite a bit of work on some caves in the northeastern part of Brazil. But it is a challenge to create these reference databases. So there's quite a number of questions here saying that how cool that is. And I have one question from Xavier Bros, and I guess this goes to Diego. So I'll ask in Portuguese, Diego. Quais são os principais obstáculos para aplicação mais ampla das técnicas moleculares, aqui no caso o eDNA, em estudos associados aos licenciamentos ambientais?
Bom, eu acho que esse é um ponto-chave que o Xavier ele tocou aí, que é a questão do custo, né? O licenciamento ambiental que envolve empreendimentos que podem impactar cavernas, ele é bem mais oneroso do que um estudo de impacto ambiental normal. Né? Você tem que fazer prospecção, tem que fazer topografia dessas cavernas, os inventários biológicos, físicos, histórico-culturais, e não é um custo simples, né? Não é um custo baixo. Você adicionar essas metodologias, principalmente as metodologias genômicas, né, ao processo do licenciamento, isso encareceria bem mais o processo. Então, por isso que eu falei que esse tipo de atividade ela poderia ser melhor realizada em grandes empreendimentos, né? Então, mas do ponto de vista do órgão ambiental, eu entendo que quanto mais informação o órgão ambiental tiver, melhores são as nossas decisões, né? Então, um empreendimento que quiser, né, ter um licenciamento ambiental melhor, né, uma tomada de decisão para o órgão ambiental mais ágil, né, com base em informações fidedignas e robustas, né, ele teria interesse em realizar esse tipo de estudo. Mas o principal impedimento que eu vejo, né, da utilização das técnicas ainda é o custo. Sem contar das limitações das próprias técnicas, né? Para a gente saber, por exemplo, que o eDNA hoje em dia... para você estimar, por exemplo, a abundância de algumas populações ainda está no início, né? Ainda está bem no começo. Então, isso teria que estar associado aos levantamentos tradicionais. Tá? Então, você teria que fazer, além do que já é feito, que é bastante caro, adicionar mais tecnologias. Então, encareceria mais ainda para você ter uma resposta, muitas vezes, talvez não fosse, por exemplo, definitiva. Né? Então, eu acho que os empreendedores, eles, diferentemente da Vale, que a gente vê que está investindo para caramba, né, no ITV, não são todas as empresas que têm condições de fazer esse tipo de estudo ainda.
Ok, thank you. So I have a question for Dirk. So Dirk, DNA Aquanet is doing some quite nice work, but we've experienced, at least in the case of sampling for plants, that we couldn't just translate what was done in Europe to our setting in the Amazon. So how you see about, I mean, they have developed everything with a focus on Europe, of course, but do you see that these technologies will have to be standardized for different environments, or you think they will have more broad, general applications?
That's a good question, actually. I think when it comes to the way approaching it with the community and every stakeholder in there, I think that is something that needs to be done pretty much everywhere, because the conditions for that change and all the regulations, regulatory agencies you deal with and everything. So Canada has a different approach than, for example, the Europeans had there. In terms of the protocols there, I think some of them probably are, DNA Aquanet had a very strong focus on one particular thing. And if you say plants, for example, that is a total different story. What they were looking is, so the framework around it is the European Water Framework Directive. So there's clearly a couple of groups of species they were looking and focusing on, which goes all the way from the fish down to diatoms, but not so much in other areas. So I'd say there's a lot of room for things that have to be redeveloped somewhere. That's not saying we cannot learn from each other. And I don't think we have to reinvent the wheel in every case. But if you guys go ahead and do something there, that's the example for the next group there. And DNA Aquanet was a relatively I'd say narrow focus in terms of aquatic things, but that's pretty much it. And very much on the, also focusing on the professional aspect, on the standardization rather than scientific exploratory stuff. Not saying they're not doing it, but that wasn't the primary goal. While when we come from that side, we're more interested in relationships between species and trying to see how we can decipher communities and all the things I haven't talked about, like all the issues that have to do with water dynamics and all that.
Yeah, so there's another question for you. You mentioned, and I quite agree, that if everybody uses different analytical tools, it makes things difficult to compare at the end. So, first part of that question is, do you think that MBrave is positioned to fill that gap where everybody sends the raw data and it crunches the data and then presents the final results? Or do you think that eventually we'll have at least for regulatory purposes, like countrywide settings for dealing with the data?
The answer would be not yet and yes. So MBrave is not at the point where I would say, yes, it can. It's very nice when you have your input data, your raw data, you want to have them filtered, you want to very easily tweak the filtering and everything else there and run it. And you are working within the CO1 context. That's important. If you're doing a 12S study, MBrave is not your go-to, because it takes the reference library from Bold. So that's already limiting, which is also for regulatory purposes an issue. And I know, for example, in Canada, and I know in the US, it's sort of similar. The agencies responsible for all these kinds of things, and there are several of them here in Canada, for example, Environment and Climate Change Canada, and then Parks Canada, they're all different. They've started to develop their own sets of things. They're not necessarily looking at MBrave. They looked at more integrated forms. There's a couple of them that have a graphical user interface and are modular, which gives them some flexibility. I think reality will be in the future. We will not have one thing to go to, but maybe very few, and you can list them as possible alternatives. And that is at least here for one project we were doing with another working group here on campus, when we had to come up with our detailed work plans, because it is in a regulatory official context. Our protocols contained two alternative ways of dealing with bioinformatic data. And for them, that was acceptable and sufficient, because in both times it's very well, as long as you document very well, I think it's fine. But it would be detrimental if we continue to have 100 different ways of doing things. But that's, I think, is really just attesting to the fact that everything is relatively new from how we were doing things for decades. And now all of a sudden, within a few years, we keep changing our data generation modes. So we're not even done with that. So,
yeah. So there's another question here that I'd like to get Dirk's perspective on that, and also Diego's on the Brazilian side. So the question is, so in Canada, are you in Canada already using eDNA evidence for regulatory purposes? And how, if not, how's that moving along with the regulatory agency? And then Diego can answer the same for Brazil, how acceptable that would be.
As I said for the question before, the agencies are starting to use it. So they have implemented, they do use eDNA evidence in some cases. It has what we call SARA, or the Species at Risk Act in Canada. They're starting to use eDNA evidence, for example, here in Ontario, to look for a particular group of salamanders, the Jefferson salamander, and it's starting to be used. So that came sort of in collaboration between university groups and the regulatory agency responsible. But they're starting to use it on their own. They have their own scientists, their own setup. They largely rely on their own laboratories. So that gives them the full control over the entire process. But yes, this is the first sign of showing it. And I know there's another big, huge program that's just starting, funded by a Canadian agency, Genome Canada, that's called, is it iDNA or iEDNA something? It's pretty big, got $12 million of funding to exactly do that. for entire Canada to standardize essays, have full reference libraries and all that in place. That is with the together with agencies. It's very similar to DNA Aquanet. Same idea to get it into the regulatory process. But yeah, we started already doing that. And it's the agencies themselves.
Uhum. E aí, Diego, você acha que em algum momento o ICMBio estará pronto para aceitar eDNA como evidência?
Olha, no caso de cavernas, a gente já está solicitando, inclusive. Está sugerindo que alguns casos sejam, algumas dúvidas que nós temos, né, possam ser respondidas com base em dados de DNA. Né? Uhum. Não ainda o IDNA, nem metabarcode, mas análises mesmo filogenéticas, filogeográficas com base em sequenciamento de sangue, por exemplo, né? Já podem responder algumas coisas. Eu imagino que o futuro é esse, os órgãos ambientais eles têm que se adaptar a isso. Né? Como eu falei, o princípio da precaução ele é um princípio que rege a legislação ambiental brasileira, mas ele não deve ser usado de forma indiscriminada. Se houver informação robusta, né, que tire a nossa dúvida, não tem por que não aceitar. Né? Uhum. Então, a gente já usa, por exemplo, dados de DNA para delimitação, para avaliação de estado de conservação de espécies ameaçadas. A gente já usa, por exemplo, a definição de áreas prioritárias para conservação. Então, por que não aceitar esse tipo de coisa no licenciamento ambiental? Né? Às vezes, o que a gente não tem é pessoas capacitadas nos órgãos ambientais para interpretar esses dados. Então, é outro problema, né, que a gente tem no Brasil, que não é só a rotatividade de pessoas dentro dos órgãos ambientais, como também a falta de qualificação. Então, acho que esse é o principal entrave para a aceitação desses dados atualmente.
Excelente, Diego. Muito obrigado. Então, assim, eu acho que como não tem mais perguntas, eu vou encerrar aqui. Como I'll switch to English now. So we have no more questions. So I'll wrap up here. And what I get the impression is that although there's still clearly the need to develop the protocols, I think we already can extract very valuable information from the technology. And from the Brazilian side, what I think we should do as a community here is work together with the regulatory agencies, the ICMBio, IBAMA, and the state and agencies, so that we can together develop acceptable protocols for generating data and analyzing it. And so I think that's a bit on us as well. So with that, I'll wrap up and give the word back to Daniel and John. Thank you.
Thank you, Guilherme. Can I make a question to Dirk?
Absolutely.
Dirk, I have just one simple question. Do you reckon we can still use the CO1 marker to do fish metabarcoding or just give up on that? It's a simple question.
You say it's simple, huh? good question. You're welcome to give it a try. Right now, the main argument against it is always, okay, we get a lot of bacterial contamination. And we have to differentiate here a little bit. If you're saying you're doing a metabarcoding approach, you're taking a water sample to figure out the community composition in a particular river or any kind of other water body, I'd say 12 S is your way to go. If you're doing a very specific species assay because you're looking only for 2-3 species that you're interested in whatever the Amazon River and you want to see if it's there, I say assays, whatever concept you use in TechMan, whatever, is working well with CO1. There's no need to throw out all our wonderful work we've done. And I think we have done, I think for CO1, we have, I just recently checked, more than half of the existing species on the planet associated with a barcode. It would be a shame if we just forget about it because we're doing eDNA. So I would say any kind of assay, CO1 works wonderfully fine because contamination doesn't play such a big role in this very specific approach. It is more because they just don't bind. It is more a problem if you do very general community assays, and their 12S is very helpful. And I don't think we have to do another big approach like let's do eyeball 2 for just another marker. What I'm seeing is, and we've done that and others do that too, if you have a particular water system and you have an expectation of what species occur, you're trying to build your small very targeted reference library and then go back and do it. So with that over time and everybody doing that and hopefully agreeing on that one marker as the one addition we need there, we slowly build up again. And by the way, just a hint, Bolt can host other markers than Core1 in its database. So you can just put it in the same system and use it there. But I think there's still a good and high value for CO1.
Thank you for your answer. I think Jonathan has a question as well.
Yeah, I just want to say that I think our experience in the megadiverse region is that 12S is not achieving specificity in a way that will allow us to reliably interpret the results. So we find that in a community, you have say 30 to 50 species of fish, and you'll get lots of congenerics that you can't distinguish within those communities. Mm-hmm. And it begins to be a bit of a problem when you want a serious analysis, because some of those species may be more important. You know, there's one abundant, and then there's the rare conservation important species in the mix there. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've worked with Site B. I know the group in Bernd Henfling and so on have developed Site B data. And that seems to be working in Europe. I haven't been able to look at it here, but I know that it's got a good resolution power normally. And the other question is, you know, whether or not, as well as doing just one gene at a time, I think we're trying to pick from our CO1 data, this is my recommendation, to get one of each O2 that we find with the classic barcoding studies and do a genome skim on it so that we just get a lot of power for one individual representing what is already an O2 in the CO1 studies.
Yeah,
I guess the latter will be the one where we should strive for eventually. It's through these skims, have just more power in what we can match. I heard the thing about 12S not being very good when it comes to very close relationships. And Site B, I think Bernd is using them. Yeah, we haven't done anything with Site B yet. It's sort of looked at 12S, but the Canadian fish river communities we're looking at are usually nicely separated from each other. It's wonderful. I can lean back and say 12S works. But there's a couple of where Coragonus or so is something we would probably look into trying out a few other markers where we get some headaches. We're playing around with different primers as well, but I think eventually we'll go to the point where we're saying, okay, if we have enough things to choose from, and we do an entire skim, larger reasons, or what I said, eventually it's probably something metagenomics related.
Yeah, with some kind of enrichment or something process as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Genome skimming is a good idea for a few, we're doing a few samples per species, but when you go to, you know, 5 samples per species, you know, considering the whole thing, then it's kind of expensive, still expensive. But eventually it's gonna be cheaper.
Oh yeah.
Actually, yeah. Okay, guess we don't have more questions. Are we good? So I think our first day was very exciting, wasn't it? There were a lot of nice talks, and I'd like to thank Guilherme for inviting Dirk and Diego. It was very, very interesting talks, and I think it's gonna help us, you know, building this, you know, knowledge about metagenomics and environmental DNA, and maybe get something close to what they're doing with Aquanet. We need to go toward that, you know, initiative. Try to talk about protocols, calling, you know, all stakeholders and try to discuss directions and maybe how to use as a regulatory data as well. So I think what Kirk just brought to us was very interesting, and